Capri Global Capital Limited. The call will start shortly. Please continue to hold. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to Q2 FY22 earnings conference call of Capri Global Capital Limited, hosted by Go India Advisors. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation completes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing *10 on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Ravikant Bhat from Capri Global Capital Limited. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Hi, everyone. This is Ravikant here. Thank you for dialing in to the Capri Global's Q2 FY22 results conference call. Like always, we shall start with opening remarks by our MD, Mr. Rajesh Sharma, followed by more detailed remarks on the earnings performance by our CFO, Mr. Raj Ahuja. Over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Ravi. Good afternoon, and thank you for joining us for a discussion on Q2 FY22 results of Capri Global, especially on a day packed with results and con calls. On the evening of Festival of Lights, let me first extend to you all warm season's greetings from the Capri Global family and wish you prosperity and happiness in the year ahead. As you all are aware, that Board of Capri Global approved Q2 FY22 results on Saturday, 30th October 2021. I hope you had an opportunity to go through the investor presentation, which has some enhanced disclosure on asset yield trends and asset quality. We have expanded the quarterly graphs to include rolling five-quarter data instead of three-quarter data so that it gives a better representation of the short-term performance trend. I shall keep my opening remark focused on the balance sheet and business initiatives. MSME, the growth in MSME was robust with nearly 41% of incremental disbursals happening in the segment. The robust 5.2% sequential AUM growth is indicative of the growth potential for the portfolio in H2 FY22. You may have noted our credit filters have been tightened with disbursal to login ratio at 31% currently compared to 34% 2 years ago. As regards affordable housing, the housing finance segment has also delivered a robust growth momentum during the quarter. Although customer segments overlap between MSME and housing finance, it is pertinent to note that salaried segment has contributed to a relatively better bounce back and recovery in this segment. As a result, the net NPA considering aggregate ECL provisions are once again negative in this segment. The construction finance segment continued to show robust momentum. It had second highest sanction in value terms in 12 quarters, the highest being in Q4 FY21. We therefore expect the vertical to contribute strongly to overall AUM growth in H2 FY22. There are no new NPA in this segment. NPA in absolute terms remained unchanged and net NPA remained negative. New car loan distribution business. I have made brief references to the new car loan distribution in the previous two con calls. In February this year, we initiated this business to distribute new car loan product of commercial banks for a fee consideration. In a short span of 8 months, we have tied up with 3 commercial banks to distribute their products and scaled up to 186 locations. We achieved a distribution volume of 342 crore in Q2 FY22. This is an asset-light model with reliance on feet on the street and minimal branch presence by leveraging our existing branches and manpower. New branch locations. We have now operate from 102 branches compared to 89 branches in Q1 FY22. Of these, 3 branches are exclusive to the car loan distribution business, while the urban retail and construction finance segment operate from the rest of the branches. We are presently focusing on growing our presence and business in Gujarat, Rajasthan, and Madhya Pradesh. While portfolio restructuring has been relatively high among all the segments in MSME, there is no further pipeline with the closure of the RBI windows and restructuring. We are tracking certain high frequency indicators like check bounce ratio, which although still not in our the desired target zone, still they are moving rapidly towards stabilization. The data is significantly better for housing and construction finance. For a competitive picture, we would like our stakeholder to continue tracking the collection efficiency on POS, which is stable. As regards human resources, our recruitment drive is driven by the branch addition and the new car loan distribution business. I would like to mention here that our branch additions are not totally virgin. We always initiate business at the location before converting it into a branch. Hence, the branch break-even even usually happens in a short span of 2 to 3 quarters. Therefore, the slightly higher than the trend cost-income ratio noted in Q2 FY22 should stabilize as new branches become more productive. We are gearing up to launch the new secure loan product. Our technology implementation process hiring is happening as we speak, and we expect that in Q1 FY23 we should be able to launch the new product, and closer to the launch we'll share the more detailed information with you all. In conclusion, I would like to reiterate that our growth team focused on secured urban retail lending is on sound footing. It shall soon be complemented by revenue streams from recently launched and soon to be launched products. We remain committed to expanding leverage through organic route and deliver mid-teen ROE to our shareholders over medium term. I now hand over to ED and Group CFO Raj Ahuja for his remarks on Q2 FY22 earnings performance.
Thank you, Rajesh. Hello, everyone. This is Raj Ahuja. I'm the ED and the Group CFO at Capri Global. I shall be presenting the key performance highlights of quarter 2 FY22. Wherever not specified, all references shall be to the consolidated financials. I shall start with the business highlights. After some roller coaster until the quarter 1 of the current year, our consolidated disbursals in our 3 main products, which is MSME, affordable housing, and construction finance, registered both quarter-on-quarter as well as year-on-year increase of 1.9 times and 3.1 times respectively. This reflected in our AUM growth, which increased 27% year-on-year and 6.5% quarter-on-quarter at a consolidated group level. You would have noted affordable housing and construction finance share in overall AUM has gone up marginally in quarter 2, while that of MSME and indirect retail lending has declined. This has been on account of a more conservative MSME expansion during this quarter. We continue to hold PTCs worth $1.73 billion, representing a pool of affordable home loans. We had purchased this pool in quarter 4 of last financial year, which carries a credit enhancement of ₹596 million. The outstanding in this pool has since run down, and current outstanding is $1.43 billion. PTCs in our balance sheet are shown as part of the investment portfolio in the balance sheet, and they are not part of AUM. Granularity in our business segments in terms of average ticket size, LTV ratios, and geography distribution remains unaffected. Overall, there is no chunkiness in any of our exposures, and individual data is clustered around the mean. Please refer to slide 14 to 16 for segmental information of our investor presentation deck. On slide 17, we have also added some granularity to the breakup of our borrowings. Although the share of commercial bank borrowings is up sequentially, we are in the process of securing more fresh lines from refinance institutions. Overall, our borrowings have remained to be a healthy mix of non-market liabilities. Slide 20 and 21 show our structural and short-term ALM positions, which remain well-matched in all the aging segments. Coming to the earnings, our net income increased 18.4% year-on-year to Rs. 1398 million, of which net interest income contributed 1180 million. Although NII growth at 12% year-on-year has trending below the AUM momentum, it may be noted that the momentum in NII had been softening previously due to a hard stop on business, as well as negative carry on funds. The trend is now reversing, and a sequential growth of 7% gives a better picture on the movements ahead, which also is in line with the sequential AUM growth of 6.5%. In this regard, the charts on the slide number 10 are instructive. The loan spreads and net interest margin shows a clear reversal on the upside after quarter four of last financial year, as we deploy higher liquidity in our core assets from the as compared to investments. Incrementally, we expect the core earnings tend to strengthen. The cost income ratio rose above the 5-quarter average trend of 37.4%. However, this is a short-term bulking up the cost as we initiated some pent-up recruitment during quarter two of the current financial year, as well as rolled out our new branches. While commenting on cost income ratio, I previously mentioned that we will structurally remain a 35 to 40% cost band, and the target stays unchanged for us. Credit costs including write-ups, declined from Rs. 181 million in quarter one to 107 million in quarter two. The credit cost to average AUM was noted at 84 bps. The credit costs in quarter two, FY22, are not directly comparable with the quarter two of the previous year, owing to the asset quality standstill classification in the previous period and associated negligible provisioning that was undertaken in the last year, same quarter. We had guided our credit cost to trend around 120 bps as we exit quarter four of this year, with an anticipated level of 150 bps for the first 9 months of the year. We are pleased to have remained well within the range while drawing comfort of being in a position to absorb higher provisions if need be in future. The quarter two FY22 net profits increased as a result of all the above 14% quarter on quarter to Rs. 525 million. I shall now turn to asset quality. Our gross stage 3 ratio softened 19 bps quarter on quarter to 3.3%, and net stage 3 ratio softened similarly to touch 61 bps. Our total restructure book stands at 2,189 million versus 2,038 in quarter one. The MSME book contributed 2,054 million and housing finance 136 million to this book. The aggregate restructuring book was 4.4% of AUM, an uptick of 3 bps quarter on quarter. There are no restructured accounts in the construction finance and indirect retail lending book. Pipeline for restructuring in MSME and housing is now nil, with the closure of RBI special dispensation window for restructuring. So we are not expecting any further addition to the restructuring book now. In summary, the quarter 2 FY22 offered fresh optimism, and we choose to ride the momentum. Vaccination have kept solid pace, and fresh COVID-19 infections have remained range-bound with an overall declining trend. I would like to hop back to what we had stated post quarter four earnings, that the first half year of this financial year shall be one of managing P&L challenges, while the second half shall offer better growth opportunities. In retrospect, we can say that a more optimistic scenario played out in H1 FY22 for us. In this backdrop, I would once again like to reiterate, CGCL has amongst the strongest capital adequacy ratios, a robust core operating profit, and multiple liability relationship to fund its growth. We therefore remain confident of our growth trajectory over medium term. Before I conclude, I'd like to wish all of you a very happy Diwali and festive season ahead. With this, I shall conclude my remarks. We shall now take questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Anyone who would like to ask a question, please press star and one. The first question is from the line of Shripal Doshi from Equirus. Please go ahead.
Hello. Thank you. And thank you for giving me the opportunity. My question was with respect to the housing disbursement. So that is close to 142 crore during the year. And we've seen a strong sequential growth there. But I also see the ticket size there has increased significantly on Q-on-Q basis. So just wanted to understand two things here. One is that what is the, how many number of applications are we seeing per month that have gone up, over the last quarter? And is the disbursement during the quarter, like was it, a lot of it was also because of the, there were a lot of cases in pipeline during the first quarter, which got disbursed during the quarter. So if you could just give that what fresh loans we got during this quarter and how much would have we disbursed for that and what was it in the pipeline and towards that what was the disbursement. So if you can just give some color there.
Yes, Shripal, so you have two questions. One is how much, whether the higher disbursement was on account of whether the first quarter cases which are already logged in, but they're disbursed. But that is a continuous process. Some of the cases which are logged in June are disbursed in July, but so is the case be in September, which are logged in, some of the cases which will get disbursed in October. So that is an ongoing thing. So that gets neutralized in every quarter. So it is not that because of that, disbursement has gone up. As far as specific number is concerned, Raj, will you be able to explain how much specific housing finance have been disbursed?
Yeah, sure. So in Shripal, so in the incremental disbursement, your observation is right that the average ticket size has gone up this quarter, but that is not because of any structural and fundamental change. This is mainly because of the fact that quarter one was a subdued quarter for us, and most of the disbursement which happened in quarter one was only the top-up of the previous sanctions. They were not actually the new sanctions. Most of the new sanctions which started happening in June, July onwards, they built up in this quarter, and that's why our average ticket size has been back at around 1.2 to 1.3. Plus also some locations which contributes to the lower value continue to be in the lockdown, some portions of Maharashtra, some portion in some other parts of the country. And that would have resulted in a little bit higher ATS this quarter. But our focus on having a very retail book in the housing finance continues to be valid. Our average ticket size will continue to be in the range of around 12 lakhs to 13 lakhs. And we are not much away. So if you see the graph also, quarter one is an aberration. All other quarters, we have been in the range of 1.1 to 1.3.
Right. So just a connected question and thing that I wanted to understand was that, are we seeing, because see, what my understanding and observation is that in the real estate sector, the segment that we cater to, there we have seen the demand to be robust and the incremental construction cost has also gone up. So we are anyway experiencing no price discounts from the developers, and in fact there are price hikes that the developers have taken. So is that also getting reflected in our fresh disbursement and in the kind of applications that we are getting currently, wherein somebody who was asking for who was taking a loan for 25 lakh ticket size home, now that is 27, 28 lakh. So probably 4-5%. Increase is also because of that, or which you can give more on a qualitative comment that you would have observed. So yeah, that's something that I wanted to understand.
I don't think, Shripal, that in our segment, like the affordable housing loan, there were too much of discounting happening earlier, which is not there. It may be some partial impact, maybe few percentage points, but it is not that the most of the discounting and the offers actually goes in the mid to higher segments, which, where we don't operate. So yes, there will be a little bit of an inflation impact. There will be some small bits of these offers and discounts no more available because of the higher construction costs. Also, there may be a little bit increase in the housing projects.
Got it. One last question was with respect to restructuring. So we have 4.4% as a restructured book. So what is the nature of restructuring that we have done for housing and for MSME loans? Like, what would be the moratorium given and what would be the extension of tenure for these for most of our customers? The range, if you can give.
So that disclosure is already there in both the press release as well as on our presentation, that our MSME book is considering the maximum of its restructured assets. Our total restructured asset book is 2,251 million, out of which 2,115 million, which is almost like 90% is MSME book, and 136 million in the housing finance segment. In terms of moratorium, it's very, very customer dependent. We have ranged between zero moratorium to around 12 or maximum, I think, 18 months moratorium. So most of the moratoriums are between 6 months and 9 months, and some flowing down to 12 months time also.
Okay. Oh, so this will be in the housing or this is in the MSME? This is across MOOC?
This is across. We have not done a separate analysis, but this is across.
Okay. So we are giving moratorium and we have not decreased their EMI or things like that, but we've just given them blanket moratorium to some of the customers, which will be in the range of 6 to 12 months.
That's right. And this is also the RBI framework, where it is left to the customer to, based on his condition, the customer is expected to ask for that kind of a moratorium, and we are bound as per the RBI guidelines to honor that request.
Got it. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. I'll come to you.
Based on our knowledge about the market also, I think everybody is in the similar range. It's not that we are much away, away from the mean in the market.
Right. Got it. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for the meeting.
Thank you, Shiv.
Thank you. Anyone who would like to ask a question, you may press star and one. The next question is from the line of Arjun Baga from Nirmal Bang Institutional Equities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, good afternoon, sir. So I had another question with respect to the restructured assets of 4.4% on our consolidated book. So I just wanted to understand that in terms of the slippages from this book, like how much are we expecting? And if you could just break that down from the MSME and from the housing.
So you are asking how much slippage will happen from the restructuring book in MSME as well as housing finance?
Yes, sir.
First of all, our portfolio is entirely secured by collateral. So every loan is secured by either hard asset, self-occupied house or self-occupied business premises. Second, the loan-to-value ratio is almost 50% in MSME and about 68% in home loans. So there is adequate security cover available. So even in these restructured portfolio, assuming that some percentage, which you expect about 20%, and this is an estimate, this can go here and there because there is no some formula by which, but our judgment is that around 20% it can slip into the NPA. Over a period of time, it will not happen in one quarter or two quarter. Even though that NPA happens, so out of 218 crore rupees, if 20% slips, even that will be scattered over a period of time. And then with the tool of surfacing other recovery methods, and because of the secured collateral and there's enough security cover of loan to value, we don't expect that this will give some kind of surprises or some kind of a credit loss which will go beyond our estimate we have given.
Sure, sir. That's helpful. And another question I had, this was regarding the branch network. So we have a target of doubling our branch network. And so in that regard, I just wanted to check, like, so how are we going to be expanding? So would it be in the existing states, or would we be targeting new geographies, or like what would be the new geographies if we target?
So we'll go deeper in the states we are currently operating. Currently, we are operating in Gujarat, Maharashtra, MP, Rajasthan, and NCR. We have already acquired the understanding of local property laws, local valuation norms, local business practices. So we'll go deeper in that, and we believe that there's adequate scope in growing our branch network in these states. Our competitor, where we have 30 branches, they already have 150 branches. So, and there's enough businesses happening. We with our regional team in presence, it is much cost effective and much smoother to go deeper in that. So first we'll go deeper in those states. Our target to go to 225 branches in next 4 to 5 years. I think we'll achieve much earlier than that. So we are not adding new geography at the moment in next 2 years. We'll continue to open our branches in current areas where we are operating.
Sure, sir. Thanks for that. And a related question. So, despite these branch expansions, so we are, I just wanted a confirmation, we are just keeping this cost income guidance at 35% to 40%. It will still remain in this ballpark.
Yeah, because when we open the branches, it is a continuous process. Still, we stabilize our branch network and all. I think, but still with the growth in AUM, it will still give it better return on equity when the AUM grows and leverage goes up. Yes, till we keep on opening the branches, that new branches will, which will stabilize in 6 to 9 months' time and achieve break-even. Hence, our cost-to-income ratio will remain in that range. Once we stop new branch opening, then perhaps it will slightly come down. Or with the gradually increase in the branches when we cross at a particular AUM, then also the cost to income ratio will come down.
Sure, sir. Thanks a lot for the answer. That clarifies it. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone who would like to ask a question, you may press star and one. The next question is from the line of Shishti from Wellvin Consulting. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hello, sir, and thanks for the opportunity. I just have two queries. So first, I wanted to get an understanding of the new car loan segment that we recently got into, and what are the economies and synergies involved in this car loan business? And also, it would be helpful if you could brief us about your future plans in this particular vertical. And second is on the home loan side. We are currently seeing strong demand scenario, and also the company is being a little more cautious than peers. So considering these things, what pace do you expect us to grow in this particular home loan segment? Thanks.
So as far as car loans are concerned, we have existing branch network of about 102 branches, and we have a frontline sales team in excess of about 1,000 employees. Plus, so we are using the cross-sell of generating the car loan lead, because new car loan NBFC cannot give, being banks are giving in the range of about 7% to 8%. However, we get a very good incentive and commission to do that. So we are leveraging on our existing branch network, our existing sales team. Besides that, we are also adding our network and some new employees specifically which are handling this new car loan origination. We get a good amount of incentive, and we expect that next year this will give a good amount of income. We expect at least 20 crore rupees will generate from this vertical alone after meeting all the expenses and all. And there is no risk involved. There is no capital employed in the segment. This is a purely fee income. And this is giving a leverage to. Going forward, currently our monthly run rate has come about 175 crore rupees, and perhaps we are among the top 2-3 in this as far as the originator are concerned. we believe that with the help of technology and further expansion and all, we should be able to achieve a volume of 250 to 300 crore rupees per month. And this should give a good profitability. In future, when we start the used car loan, this will be a good database of the customer when they sell their car and some customer wanted to buy. So some leverage also it will be given when we start the used car loan financing for which we are evaluating. So overall, this should be a good give kicker to our return on equity. As far as home loan is concerned, we are operating in affordable housing finance segment with the conservative valuation, and we are focusing more on a salaried income where we are getting good credit line for NHB at a very attractive interest rate of 3.5%. So we are adding more salaried customer whereby we are earning 6% spread. We still can compete in the market because we are lending to the rural, which government and NHB wanted to promote by giving the low interest rate loans. There is a huge demand supply gap in terms of availability of loans, and the new houses of smaller sizes are being built after the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana credit subsidy has kicked in. So even though when we give the loan, there is a margin of own contribution put up by the borrower. Plus, when the home subsidy, interest subsidy comes from Government of India, about 2,30,000 rupees, that further improve our loan-to-value ratio. So in this segment, risk is minimal. Except the fraud cases, we are not bound to lose the money in this segment. The challenge remains that within the high operating cost, how do we improve our margins? So I think that will happen with the scale. So I do not think there is a huge credit risk involved. I think that the high operating cost is some challenge which we have to deal with and improve our return on equity.
Okay, got it. That is helpful. And one more question, if I may ask. So our MSME collection efficiency was slightly lower at 85.9% versus 86.5% last quarter. So what are the challenges here that we're facing, and how do you see the same shaping up ahead?
So if you see in MSME, the non-paying standstill portfolio currently is about 13%, while the collection efficiency is near about 86%. Okay. Thereby, it means we accept the restructured portfolio. Nearly all the customer is servicing their dues in MSME. We expect that with the full-fledged economy is now rebounded, COVID impact is negligible, businesses are bouncing back, activities are the pre-COVID level. I think with the enhanced demand in the MSME sector, the business level activity will go up. So the requirement of the new loan, so business will grow. Similarly, their income also improve. Their ability to repay will improve. So we do not see that there will be any surprises in that. I think worst phase in MSME segment is over. Now, whatever little challenge we have in restructured portfolio over a period of time with their improvement in the income, I think we should be able to do well, and we should be able to do contain our delinquency. Our now courts surfacey action, which was prohibited, is also opened up. So that will also give a bump to the recovery proceedings and result thereon. So the new NP will keep coming, or will getting resolved, and this cycle will go on like this. But we expect our NPA and GNPA will remain overall in the stated range.
Yeah, got it. Thanks so much for the time, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, you may press star and one to ask a question. The next question is on the line of Ankita Nair from Rubix Investment. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thanks for the opportunity. So I have a couple of questions. When I look at your pre-COVID presentation, say 2 years back, you were targeting a growth of around 40 to 45% CAGR. And now it's in the range of 22 to 27, if I'm not wrong, for the next 5 years. So what has changed? Is it COVID, or there is some change in the business strategy? Could you please throw some light on that?
Yes, so I think with the increased base and the impact of COVID have slowed down the 1 year growth. Plus, we are launching a new product. And with various discussion within the company, including the board, we have decided to keep our growth targets in the range of 22-27%. And if you've seen quarter on quarter, we are trying to achieve that growth. Last year, all the four quarters combined put together, we've grown 20%. And this year, we are on course to deliver the growth between 20-27%. Long-term growth, we have decided to keep in this range only. And there is no change in the strategy except that we'll add a couple of products in the gold loan. And we also started this new car loan distribution and tied up with the three banks. So we'll remain on our stated strategy and our growth will be in this range, 22-27%.
All right, got it. My next question is regarding the construction finance division. So now, do you see like better growth given that there is a real estate boom, and or will you like see or will you maintain a cautious approach with respect to growth over here?
Our major growth driver will be always MSME and affordable housing. The construction finance on overall level will be below 25% and then more in the range of about 20%. So, while we are cautious, our ticket size is lower, our collection efficiency is better, our portfolio is doing well. But growth major will happening from MSME and affordable housing. So this segment will not go beyond, it will between 20-25% of overall AUM of the company.
Okay, got it. And lastly, how do you expect the asset quality management in the ahead for the next two quarters? And do you see any surprises in MSME sector happening?
I don't think so, because economy activity levels are back and we are clearly seeing the COVID, whatever third wave are expected, it doesn't look like that will happen and we'll face any lockdown again. With this hope and assumption, we do not think there will be any surprises in MSME affordable housing segment.
I think that's all from my side. Thank you for your time, sir.
Thank you. Anyone who would like to ask a question, you may press star and one. The next question is from the line of Palak Chopra from Kapoor Capital Private Limited. Please go ahead.
Hi, thank you so much for taking up my questions. So, sir, my first question is that I wanted to know, how are you moving ahead in terms of leveraging technology in your business model, given that it's the only way forward and so many new fintechs have already entered the foray? Just wanted to know your opinion on that.
So, as you rightly said, now that new age is that we have to use the more technology to reduce the overheads and to make the processes better and faster. We already employed one of the best consulting firms, BCG, where they are guiding us and advising us on tightening our processes, using more technology, data analytics. While in our business, front end cannot be entirely on technology because we are dealing with the customers who have no income proof. But there are various tools like customer app, sales mobility application, collection app where immediately receipt can be issued, data can be updated, balance can be shown. All those are being implementation. And in a phased manner, the first phase should be over by 31st March. And we'll see that there will be improvement efficiency, there will be improvement in the overall productivity of the sales team. So we are focusing our these areas where I think without increasing manpower, if we can improve our overall productivity, that will give us a very flip in the profitability. So we are working on the technology side. We are using best of the consultants. Recently, we hired a CTO. We have hired a head data analytics. So there is enough focus to build the team with the right people in technology team and data analytics team.
Right, sir, right. So my second question is that our cost to income have inched up again. So as I can see, we have added a lot on our employees this quarter. So which business verticals are we hiring more? And what should be the cost income expectations for the full year, if you can give something on that?
The full year cost to income ratio will remain in range of about 40 to 42%. We have added more employees in the MSME affordable housing and also in new car loan origination. Plus, we have added a lot of people who come at a significant cost in the technology and data analytics teams, which have also contributed to the higher cost. But they will result in a great saving in terms of tightening of processes and lower cost in terms of better productivity. So those benefits also will accrue next year.
Okay, okay. And sir, I'm expecting that, you know, no capital raise is, you know, required at this point, or maybe over next few years also. So if you could just shed some light on the ROE targets of yours going forward.
So I think we have given you our presentation on our website also. Over a period of next 5 years, we are targeting a ROE in the range of 16 to 18%. Already this quarter's ROE is about in the range of 11.7%, and if you talk about H1, about 11.5%. Next two quarters, I think, will be better. So we hope that ROE will be in the range of about 12%. But more we leverage, more our AUM goes up, ROE will slowly will move towards our targeted area of 16 to 18%, and that might take 3 to 4 years time.
Right. So one last question. Well, what was the rationale to bid for IPL team? What would have been the cash flow outflow had we not won the bid? And also, does KP balance sheet has this much strength?
So that bid was not from the listed entity. That was from one of the promoter entity, and that entity would have handled it from their own sources.
Oh, okay, okay. Thanks for the clarification, sir. That was all from my side.
Yeah.
Thank you. As there are no further questions from the participants, I now hand the conference over to the management for closing comments.
Yes, so as we said, we will continue to grow on our stated strategy of growing the book through MSME, affordable housing, catering to those customers who are in a no-income proof segment, and add the more secure product. So our entire philosophy of serving those customers who do not get access credit from the banking system will remain intact. And we believe that now economy is back on track. Activity levels are back, even rural and urban area both are bouncing back. Festive season is, we are seeing the full activity. So with this hope, we see that next second half will be better than the first half significantly. And in long run, with the adequate capital adequacy in place, good banking line in place, and good collection efficiency, and sharp focus, and now we are almost in this business more than 8 years, we see that we'll continue to grow in the range of about 20 to 27%. And with this, we are quite confident to improve our profit year after year as we have done in the past. Thank you.
Thank you. On behalf of Go India Advisors, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.